Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I get into the questions, I'd like to thank both panels for being here to testify today about the current state of Dodd-Frank implementation. Particularly, thank you to Mr. Larry Thompson, General Counsel for the Depository Trust and Clearing Corporation, who's come before the committee before to testify, particularly on the merits of legislation H.R. 742, the Swap Data Repository and Clearinghouse Indemnification Correction Act of 2013. I certainly appreciate my colleague, Congressman Sean Patrick Maloney, for joining me as a co-sponsor of this bill. And finally, Chairman Gensler, I'd like to thank you, as you're charged with the difficult task of improving market transparency and systemic risk mitigation in the global derivatives market. I'm hopeful the CFTC will achieve these goals, and I introduced H.R. 742 to fix the Dodd-Frank provision, which threatens to undermine the bipartisan goal of enhancing transparency and mitigating systemic risk. Currently, Dodd-Frank law includes a provision requiring a foreign regulator to indemnify a U.S.-based SDR for any expenses arising from litigation relating to a request for market data. Unlike most of the world, the concept of indemnification is only established within U.S. tort law. As a result, foreign regulators have been reluctant to comply with the provision, and international regulatory coordination is being thwarted. While the idea of the provision was to protect market confidentiality, in practice, it threatens to fragment global data on swap markets. Foreign regulators will be forced to create their own SDRs, resulting in fragmented global data framework where regulators can't possibly see a complete picture of the marketplace. Without effective coordination between international regulators and SDRs, monitoring and mitigating global systemic risk is severely limited. H.R. 742 fixes this problem, and while the CFTC seeks to clarify this provision through interpretive guidance, all indications are that there's no viable solution without adopting my legislation, as we'll hear from Mr. Thompson later in the day. So with that, I have the following question for you, Chairman Gensler. Recently, your colleagues, Commissioners Summers and Chilton, both testified before this committee and agreed that H.R. 742 is a necessary fix to the indemnification provision of Dodd-Frank. The SEC testified to that same effect before the Financial Services Committee last year. Do you agree or disagree with your colleagues?
I think that you've provided us in Title VII a great deal of flexibility, and we've used that flexibility in the interpretation we've done. The bill, as I understand it, is consistent with that, and it is certainly something that international regulators would like that extra step. I mean, what we did in the interpretation that we put out that you referenced is that international regulators, if in their statute, anywhere in that statute, they have authority to get that information, then the indemnification doesn't apply. So we interpreted it, I think, just about as broadly, but your bill certainly just goes further by just removing the indemnification altogether.
You've indicated that interpretive guidance would be enough to address the indemnification problem. So I think, as you just indicated, global regulators disagree and have expressed that they actually support the legislative approach. I'm just wondering why there was a difference of opinion there.
Well, we've addressed it. I think that in some circumstances, global regulators would like to see information that they don't necessarily have authority to see, that their local laws or legislation haven't given them the authority to see. And so I think, as they've expressed to us, for instance, they might want to see in these data repositories information about U.S. traders who might do a transaction referencing one of their government rates or something. So they wanted to go a little further in what they could see.
Okay. Why are reforms like cross-border guidance at CFTC being made through interpretive guidance and staff no-action letters versus a formal rulemaking process? Shouldn't the CFTC follow the Administrative Procedures Act requirements?
With regard to guidance, we do follow the Administrative Procedures Act quite closely. There's been four or five places where we were not asked to do rules, but somebody's come in and said, can you interpret some words in the statute? And this cross-border provision is something that Congress put in. It's actually technically called Section 722D. That did not have a required rulemaking and, furthermore, is not in the provisions for the Securities and Exchange Commission. This was one place that it was not the same. And so we had a lot of people come in. We debated whether we just left it to facts and circumstances, issue no interpretation, or put out an interpretation, or thirdly, put out an interpretation subject to public comment. We chose the third to get the public input, and yes, we've gotten a lot of public input. I would include this hearing in that public input.
Sure.
So it's been very helpful to interpret these words and, I think, give guidance.
Appreciate that. You anticipated my next question, so I don't have to ask it. I'm out of time. Appreciate you. Chairman Gensler, yield back.
Chairman, yield back.